Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to St. James Church. For those of you who worship here or are used to worshiping here, you'll recall that one of our traditions is that we do not applaud during a service. But this is not a service. This is a concert. So if you feel so moved to applaud, feel free. In fact, let's practice. I'm delighted to welcome everyone here. My name is Tom Hill. I'm senior warden here at St. James for about another 78 days for this time. This concert is being held to honor our beloved rector, Vanessa Clark, who is going to be moving to Omaha, Nebraska soon, where she will become Dean of Trinity Cathedral there. And one of the ways that we wanted to show her just how much we have loved her here and will continue to love her is with music and song. So thank you, Mother Vanessa, for all of your support. And now, as they say, on with the show. Our director of music, William Benner, and our St. James Choir and some select individuals who, well, we can remain nameless for a while, will be presenting this concert of love for Mother Vanessa. Thanks for being here.
The first three pieces are from England, And no, that's not a typo. It's supposed to be tuba tune, but turns out the English call trumpet tunes tuba tunes because generally the strongest stop in the organ is a tuba in England, and that's what they call it. So, you know, if we spoke the same language, we wouldn't have that problem. Okay, next I'm going to play from the Planet Suite of Gustav Holst, the very familiar, beautiful Jupiter theme. And I'm going to follow that up with the variation number 9 from the Enigma suites of Sir Edward Elgar. He is the guy that wrote Pomp and Circumstance. Everybody who knows that. Actually, he wrote 4 Pomp and Circumstances. And when I was a young man, I went into a music store and I saw on sale number 3, and I grabbed it up and paid my 50 cents or whatever it was. And I got it home and it wasn't what I wanted. I wanted number 1, which is the familiar one from Graduations. But anyway, he wrote this little musical puzzle for his friends. And I always thought it was the names of the people. He took one little theme and he made 14 variations, and they were about friends of his. And this one is called Nimrod. In the Bible, Nimrod was a grandson of Noah, and he was a mighty hunter. And he wrote this for his friend Augustus Jaeger. And Jaeger means hunter in German. And he was his music publisher. And this is the one that has kind of gained notoriety, and it's played in England frequently. I understand it, festive occasions and whatever. So those 2 pieces are coming up.
Thank you.
everybody here? Hear me on the back? Okay, good. I think that piece kind of explains the feeling Mozart had when he said, the organ is the king of instruments. Anybody disagree? That's amazing. Okay, now we have three pieces that involve our parish choir. Number one, Becky's going to sing a setting, she's going to play a setting of an old American, early American hymn, Shall We Gather By the River? And then the choir is going to sing one of their favorite anthems, and Jen Webster is going to sing the Lord's Prayer. Councilman Johnny. The next two pieces, the Grand March from Aida is really grand. Really grand. The Last Rose of Summer utilizes this, I'm going to use the harp style. There are two things, let me digress just a second. This organ, as it stands here right now, is 95 years old. It was installed in this building in 1926 by Ernest Skinner, who was the premier organ builder of the early 19th century. Amazing man. And by the time this organ was installed, his two factories in Massachusetts were building 50 organs a year. Now, that may not sound like a lot, but that's about one a week. And this is a relatively small instrument. It has 32 ranks of pipes. And that means there are 2,150 pipes in this organ, in the two rooms that are where you see the arches. And to just give you a perspective, there's an organ, a Skinner organ at Lake Erie College, which was put in a little more than a year after this one. This is number 608, and one at the college is 647. And they're only separated by about 13 months. Ours was in late 1926, and one at the college was early 1928. And that organ is twice the size of this organ. And the one at Seven Saw, which has just been refurbished in the last 15 or 20 years, is three times the size of this organ. And the organ that Mr. Skinner built for the Cleveland Public Auditorium and Music Hall, which was in sometime in the 30s, that was 150 ranks, so it was five times the size of this organ. Okay? And imagine cranking out 50 of these monsters a year. That all came to a halt, actually, in 1929, partly because of a stock market crash, and partly because a couple of years ago, prior to that, actually I think it was 1927, Hollywood came out with their first talking movie. So there were no longer any more organs sold to movie theaters. And that was a big part of the organ building business. But anyway, there were two things that were left off of this organ, but were prepared for. One was a harp unit, and one was chimes. And when this organ was renovated in 2009 and 2010, those things were added. They were picked up from other Skinner organs which had been put out to pasture. So we're lucky to have an unaltered, complete organ. And there's a lady here today that you should thank for that. And that's Julie Siegel. Without her leadership and her tenacity, this probably would never have happened. And it's wonderful. Truly, I thank you from the bottom of my heart that you saved this organ for this parish, and that I'm still alive to be able to play on it. So, The Last Rose of Summer, if you listen carefully, you'll hear the harp in the accompaniment. And
this is an American trumpet tune, and this fellow David Turman wrote it as a surprise for his wife, and was played at their wedding for the first time. So it's a neat piece. Okay.
Thank you.
terrific key change that's, you don't want to hear about it. I did turn on the other add-on that I forgot to mention. You hear it now. It's called a Zippelstern. It's a German word, means a bell star. And if you go to European churches in Germany that have 18th century organs, you'll see a prominent star on the front of the organ case. And behind it, there are little tiny bells. When the organist turns it on, the star rotates and the little bells tinkle just like that. We don't have the star, but we got the bells. We can't really call them choir members, but they're St. James musicians. Tom Hill is going to sing Amazing Grace, and Jessica is going to sing You'll Never Walk Alone, which is from Carousel. And it was actually written by both Rodgers and Hammerstein. Only Rodgers got into the credits. We started off with a piece in B major, so we're down to the very end, and we're going to do a piece in B minor, and you might even recognize it. Thank you.
Bill just asked if it might be appropriate to do an encore. How does everybody feel about that? Yeah.
Thank you again so much for coming. Thanks also to Ellen Leitman and Sally Hewis for the refreshments. COVID safe, we really appreciate it. Thank you all.
May I take an executive?
Please.
I'd like to be grateful and clear that when I announced my departure, the vestry asked me, well, how do we say goodbye? And there are all kinds of ways to do that. We could have just ignored it and I could slip out the back door. But knowing this place, we don't like to show off, but we don't like to say goodbye either. We couldn't feed you because of COVID. That wouldn't be particularly safe either. And so I prayed around it, and I texted Bill and said, would you be willing to do a concert for me? And I am delighted not only that he said yes, but that the choir said yes, and our soloists were willing to say yes, and Tom and Phyllis, our live stream guru over here, also said yes. The legacy that I leave behind is not the organ that was restored with Julie Siegel's primary help, or what we did in the other building improvements that we've been able to make. It's not the program or the honors or the plaques or even that wonderful statue that you won from the NAACP. My legacy here is you. It is those who I have baptized, those who I have married, those who I have buried, those who I have comforted, and I hope, in some small part, those who I have blessed. Thank you each one for coming out today, and I wish you Godspeed and a wonderful life in the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you, Tom. So I love Trinity Sunday. I love hard problems to talk about. You always get Trinity Sunday wrong, because to even describe the Trinity is heresy. And when I was in seminary, one of the more ridiculous analogies that was used was the peanut M&M, which has to have all three interconnected in order for it to be one. And so the three in one and the one in three God is also a peanut M&M, the peanut, chocolate, and a hard candy shell. Enjoy.